Good evening, everybody. It's 7 o'clock, so we're going to get started. Before we've got two hearings tonight, but before we get started, there's the public comment portion of the evening. And although there's not a lot of public out there, is there anybody who's sitting down who has anything, any comments that don't have anything to do with the two hearings in front of us tonight? If you do, raise your hand. If not, we'll get started. Okay, let's begin. The first hearing is scheduled for 7 o'clock. It's a site plan amendment from Wright Builders for the Upper Ridge Phase 4 at State Hospital by modifying a unit layout at Village Hill Road and Ford Crossing, map ID 31C-18, as published on February 26th and March 5th. We have a presentation.
Just a small one, yes. Yeah, hi, everybody. Mark Ledwell. I'm a principal with Wright Builders. This is going to be the final phase of our development of the so-called Upper Ridge parcel up at Village Hill. And we're proposing modifying that phase four for us from 2 3-unit buildings to a 2-unit building and 3 single-family homes. We're doing this for different reasons. One of them is it seems to be a better mix and blend and for absorption in the market for us. We're building a series of other multi-family homes right now. And we also tend to think that this phase, which was from our perspective, somewhat conceptual, would be better served by a blending of the single families into existing single families homes that are on Ford Crossing right now. So we're bringing this forward and trust that it's all well. We present past materials through DPW. I've actually talked to them and everything seems fine there. I imagine you've heard that. So that's it.
Thank you. Any questions by the board?
Questions or?
Is there any conflict with the overall master plan originally with conceptually, big picture wise, with the proposed changes?
I mean, I think this whole block was sort of a transition from higher density to lower density. And in my staff report, I mentioned that there were two triplexes facing Ford Crossing, and it sort of left this big gap. I mean, you can see in the plans on the end of Village Hill. So I think in terms of bringing that density or that massing along Village Hill spine, which was sort of the intended main higher density corridor section of the plan, sort of this new design, I think ties in better than having the side end of a triplex that goes, that was heading towards a mix of singles and twos around Ford Crossing. I think it's a little bit different from the other project on, I guess it was Meesanti, where there was, I think staff felt there was more conflict with reducing in that section going to single family because everything around it was multifamily and attached housing. And in this case, I think there is a spread of single family along Ford Crossing, and I don't think it has the same impact because everything north of it is sort of singles and twos anyway. Mm-hmm. So I think from that perspective, it's probably not a significant change to the overall master plan. And I think it ties the density in better by wrapping the duplex around the corner than it had before.
Right. I agree. It is a transitional point in the campus layout. And as far as when you're on Village Road, I think that transition reads better in the proposed layout just because of what faces Village Road. But any comments from the board?
I hear Carolyn saying that the actual massing of the buildings at that end and the transition to the other buildings makes sense. And so I'm not going to not, you know, I'm not interested in not having this happen, but I cannot let this go without saying it has been such a slippery slope to go from an idea of a village to an idea of a subdivision. Mm-hmm. And so we have leaned towards single family. I don't know your business well enough. I suspect you make more off the single family homes. But I had really hoped that we would get a lot more density out of this than eventually transitioning to single family. So it's just a statement. You've got your business, but we have seen this be built in phases, and every phase has just that little bit to it each time. And so I'm sorry about that.
I agree. I think where we've voiced that opinion in a stronger manner was closer to the center of campus, where that got away from us a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I don't see this. I think this really is a transitional point, because on the other hill, on the other side of Ford, it's mostly all single family. So this is that point where you're supposed to, I think, in the master plan, going from a more dense layout to a less dense layout. So if this was closer to the center, I would strongly agree.
I'm curious as to what the presumed price of the duplexes would have been and what the presumed price of the single families are. That is, what's the price point of the shift in these two designs?
I'm not sure there's a lot of shift in price point, and I don't have the exact any marketing or exact pricing information for you. I would guess that the single families will cost more. You know, there'll be more. They're intended to be, and it's not necessarily because we make more money off of them. But they do cost more. There's more building, and one of them is going to be is planned to be a single story, fully accessible building. That's important to us, and I appreciate the comments that it's a better transition. We really think it is a better design than what we had before, and particularly that corner of Ford Crossing and Village Hill Road. We have a nice design that addresses both sides of the street in a way that a two-family can, that a three-family can't, and really believe that we're stepping down to the single-family land. We build one fewer unit. It was going to be six. It's now five. We pay the same for the land. We pay for the infrastructure. None of that's changed. So there's no money to be made really by doing this. It does make sense for us, and we think it's all going to be better in the end. This particular phase, I think, is 28 units, so we move to 27. I don't think there's a great loss of density there.
I think at the heart of Ann's question is just the sort of elevator.
For affordability, I suppose,
cost.
You know.
Right.
I hear that, yeah. Mm-hmm. I hear that. And the condo townhouse multifamily units do cost less than single family homes for the reasons we all know why. But they're all going to be the same high standards of building, ENERGY STAR, LEED certified, nice places, very durable. We're pleased with it all.
What level are you gunning for, any certain level of LEED certification, or just
mostly all silver? Yeah, we have gold going on now. We have gold LEED going on our six family units that we're doing right now. Mm-hmm. And the current phase is one going up now, another to start in July, the next one on the opposite side of and they're really nice. If you went by, go take a peek. They really work. So, and those will be gold certified.
Absolutely, curiosity question, but are you preparing the garages for electric vehicles?
No, we don't have a plan. That's a good point, though. It's interesting. We don't have a planned plug-in. Plenty of power right there. Certainly could happen. Yeah, one of those little WeGo things are pretty easy to put in.
Any other questions by the board before we open it up to public? No. Is there anyone here from the public who wishes to comment on this project? No. Okay. Motion to close.
Just wanted to note that there are a couple of utility comments from DPW. I don't know if you received those forwarded up to you in your office.
Today?
Yeah.
When it was out today.
But they're minor, you know, adjusting the utility connections you'd have to do anyway when you go through building permits. So that's the only
thing. Yeah, I hadn't heard. I brought stuff to Dave and everything seemed fine. Okay.
Okay, I need a motion to close public comment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Second.
Second, John. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay. Any further discussion? I mean, in the grand scope of things, we're losing one unit, but I agree with you. This is on the tail end of losing several units along the way. We're just on the outskirts of along the way. So I think the pain is felt a little less, but...
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'd be curious to hear, but I mean, for those of you that have been involved from day one, I kind of come in the middle here. I mean, but it does sound like, you know, there's been, because you're looking at it piece by piece by piece, so nothing big happens on any particular piece, but then at the end of the project, it's a lot different than what you started with.
Each piece seems to have come in sort of like this. I mean, I think this one is one of the least offensive changes because it is at the end, but... Mm-hmm. I mean, I was handed a bumper sticker the other day that said Village Nil, you know, and it some of it isn't feeling like a village because of it's feeling more like a subdivision, but it's the master plan was held up and as an idea rather than as a agreed to plan. And then as each developer, of which, you know, Wright's done some really nice work up there. So it's not a statement about, you know, the houses that they're building. It's just I'm much more frustrated by Mass Development's planning of the entire project, and yet they've had constraints on trying to find the right developers to come in, so they can't control all of it either. I don't know if that helps. It's kind of sounding like a broken record. Every time we do one, mm-hmm. I want to say the same mm-hmm. thing. Mm-hmm. Right. So
I think we did two or three or four of these, you know, in a bubble, and then we stepped back and looked at what we had created and realized that from a density level, it wasn't, when you compare it to the master plan, it wasn't following strictly that lineal path. It was kind of getting off path a little bit.
And the plan had comments in it like workforce housing, you know, I mean, so that was getting to
that's
what your
exactly
interest was,
right,
which is lower cost housing within right. walking distance of town.
Right.
So we're talking, I think we're talking in general right now, specifically to this project. Any issues with this?
No.
Can I hear a motion? So we have one condition, I guess, for the DPW comments that were technical in nature but need to be adhered to.
I move we approve site plan amendment Wright Brothers Upper Ridge Phase 4 at State Hospital by modifying unit layout at Village Hill Road and Ford Crossing Map ID 31C18 Northampton with DPW conditions.
Second.
Second, yeah. Discussion. Favor? Thank you.
Like some $200,000, $300,000 houses up there.
It's like death by a thousand paper cuts. It's just
right, right.
Yeah. It does. Well, and it came through the period of the poor housing period. I mean, you know, that started just at the wrong time.
It's been
I know that, but still.
You'd be curious to track over time when it's all done. How many people move from within Northampton to there? Mm. How many people move from outside?
Right, right.
Just, I wonder how that will shake out in the
I bet Pat's got a good idea about that.
Yeah.
And there's more coming. I mean, there's still,
oh, yeah,
you know, the male attendance building that's going to be fit out to propose affordable, more affordable living.
More affordable. And that's the point. I mean, more affordable.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. While we're setting up, we've got some minutes to approve from February 26th.
So moved.
Yes.
I second it.
Any discussion? All in
favor?
Nope,
we're good.
Wait. Come on, keep up. Come on. John kept, John, second by Deb.
They weren't exactly long. Those were your record minutes.
This one, Mark wants to frame those.
But I still hear Franny in the back of my mind, why are we so late on minutes?
You know, Sarah's been getting some grief about it.
Oh, yeah.
They are late.
While we're setting up, I have actually two disclosures. So I've worked on a past project with Otera at Smith College on AT&T cell tower. So I don't see any issues with that, but I wanted to make it known. And then I live on Rockland Heights Road, which is one block from this project. I wasn't on the abutters list because I didn't.
So you're fine.
Okay, very good.
I was just going to look for the abutters list.
I didn't receive anything,
yeah,
so I'm
okay.
Assuming.
Yeah, you're fine.
Just out of curiosity, why wouldn't she have been on the abutters list?
If she's more than 300 feet from the property boundaries.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sounds like.
We all set? Okay, I'd like to open up the second hearing scheduled for 7:15. It's for a special permit and site plan to amend the original permit by adding a three-story, 31,479 square foot addition to the Rock Ridge by Deaconess Abundant Life Communities at 25 and 37 Coles Metal Road, Northampton Map ID 13-73, as published on February 26th and March 5th. Presentation by?
My name is Jesse Marino. I'm with Proterra Design Group. I'm a project engineer. I'm with here a representative with Rock Ridge, Chris Intros. We also have Reverend Herb Taylor behind me, the executive director, Beth Vittori, and DMS Design, who's doing the architectural work, Sid Silveira. And what we're here tonight for is major site plan approval and an amended special permit for an addition to the Rock Ridge Retirement Care Facility. And before we just get into the details here, I just wanted to give the applicant an opportunity to discuss a little bit about what they do out at Rock Ridge and what the overall plan for expansion is.
Well, thank you. I'm Chris Intros, CEO of Deaconess Abundant Life Communities. I'm going to take issue right away with Jesse. It's not a facility, it's a community. What we do is build communities. The Deaconess Association was formed in 1889, one of the oldest not-for-profit providers of senior living services in Massachusetts. Hopefully you all know Rock Ridge. Rock Ridge provides independent living, assisted living, level 4 rest home services, dementia care services. And really one of our ongoing goals missionally is to meet the changing needs of the community. We're not here to sort of jump on board with a trend or to build something that doesn't need to be built. We're here to respond to the needs of the community. The Deaconess commissioned a survey of this community, a market study 2 years ago, basically to say, not would you like us to build an assisted living or would you like an independent living or would you like a nursing home? We commissioned a survey to say, what do the older adults of this community want? And the response was overwhelmingly, support services and housing that's not quite as expensive as what many of the offerings are. So we've been working over the last few years to develop a plan that will provide those services, and I'll ask Beth to describe the plan a little bit more in detail.
Beth Vittori again. I'm the executive director at Rockridge, and it's been a pleasure to be there. We've been open and providing services in our mission for just shy of 44 years. And at this point, like Chris was mentioning, what we're looking to do is really further our mission to the fullest capacity. And truly what we want to do strategically with the surveys is hopefully fulfill a gap that's really out there in our community. It's throughout the country, but really here, we want to take that risk and provide a moderately priced rental, an independent rental community for really the ladies and gentlemen in the middle class. There are a lot of different homes and communities that provide housing and services for people that have great wealth, a lot of assets, and then there are communities that also can provide services where people can utilize subsidies like Mass Health or the low-income taxing house credits or where you're using your CPA funds. This is something different. And that's what we're looking to do on the second and third floor, is open an independent rental for moderate income ladies and gentlemen, 62 or above. So that's, again, really what we're what our target is for the second and third floor, which are all apartments. There are different, some basic amenities and services that will be provided as well, but it's not truly a full-out assisted living, and again, it's really priced for people that are right in between, a very, very underserved population of people, especially, again, right here in Hampden County, Franklin County, Hampshire County first. and then also one of the really important pieces of this project currently, if you are familiar with Rockridge, we have a Gardens neighborhood, which is an assisted living memory support neighborhood. It's on the third floor of the original building, the brick building. That's not ideal for people that have cognitive impairments. It's better to have a first floor neighborhood where people can have that ease of going inside and outside and not feel as trapped, still have some control, be able to take ownership of their lives and do that, be able to go in and out. This project would allow us to bring the Gardens neighborhood back to, or down to, the first floor. And so that's really, again, a very, very important piece of the project that we want to make sure is known. And then the current third floor would be repurposed back to the original mission of the community, which is residential care. So we would be also able to offer more housing and services for people that really need Mass Health and also need that affordability component. So that's a quick snippet of what we're looking to do, and this is one of the massing renderings for you to see as well.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the site design a little bit. So the goal here is that we're building a 31,470 square foot addition, three stories. We'll talk a little bit more about the architecturals later. We have someone from Sid from DMS here to do that. I'm going to talk to you first a little bit about where we are and some of the site design components here. So, we're located at the corner of North King Street and Coles Meadow Road, right across from the State Police Barracks. This is sort of a view here. So we got North King Street here, we got Coles Meadow Road, Laurel Park's in the back here, and so the facility is, the community, we'll fix that, the community here is in this area here. Really, there's a couple of components here. The original building, built in the 70s, is a brick building in the front. And then in 2003, they added the addition here. So what they're looking to do now is to expand further in this southern corner here. Looking at the overall property, it's just under a 12-acre site. It's sort of in a trapezoidal shape here. The original building is here. The addition that was done in 2003 is in this area. We're going to focus in on this lower corner here. Again, we're at the corner of North King Street and Coles Meadow Road. The addition is going to go between and actually connect into this brick building here. And it's going to be an L-shaped that ties into an existing residence that's at the corner here. There's an existing garage that's here that's going to be taken down. Currently, there's three curb cuts. The main entrance is off of Coles Meadow. There's a service entrance here on the side on 5 and 10. This residence has its own curb cut here. One of the benefits of the addition here, we're going to connect everything together. This garage is going to be removed, so we're going to result in less curb cuts. The way we're going to do that is, currently this is basically a service entrance. We're going to expand this, and we're going to, right now it's kind of underutilized, so we're going to expand that for the parking for our new facility here. The current site has 100 units. The addition to that, we're going to propose to add 39 units on the three floors. And again, we're down in this lower left this lower corner here, and we're L-shaped, connecting from that residence at the street to the existing facility, excuse me, community that's here. Overall, you know, there's going to be a network interior that you can go all throughout the facility here, as much as the exterior as well, and we'll get into that. As far as site, what's proposed, again, the L-shaped addition is here. It's three stories. We're upgrading the service entrance here for 25 parking spaces in this area. There's a small garden area in the back with some outdoor seating, and we're proposing to extend the sidewalk along Coles Meadow Road to enhance the pedestrian circulation throughout the facility as well. Zooming a little further here, our parking area features some impervious pavement, so that's a little low impact development treatment we've been able to put in here. Some of the areas that aren't are just too close to the existing building and aren't suitable, but where we've could, we're using pervious pavement. In the back here, you can see this is the area where they'd have some outdoor seating and a connection to the existing building. It's going to be surrounded by a fence, and we have new pedestrian circulation here and along the street. As far as utilities, the existing site is up here, and in its drainage system is kind of upgrading of us. What we needed to do is to provide an independent drainage system for this addition, and what we did is we grabbed the roof drains and infiltrated them in the ground here, and what's left over from our pervious parking, we have a second underground facility here. It's a state-of-the-art system meeting all the current regulations with stormwater. It has been reviewed by DPW, and we do have our permit on that. As far as sewer and water, this is, even though it's connected, it's designed as an independent building, so it's getting its a new domestic and fire service. We are also, it gets a and I can show that a little better on this plan here. So the water service we were talking about is here. We're also getting a new feed underground electric with backup power. We're one of the things that was complicated a little bit here is that the existing sewer for this the brick building kind of goes underneath where we are now. So we've had to relocate that and tie it back into the street. And the new sewer for this building is going to head westerly to the upgraded pump station that's located in the corner here. That was part of the 2003 addition. A couple other things is that there's some gas lines that need to be relocated and connected to serve this new building. We did do site lighting. There isn't much lighting. We're proposing basically six galleon LED luminaires, and they're basically in the same style as the 2003 edition, except they are LED, which are we use a lot less power. They are available. One of the comments that came back was, how hot or cold the lighting is, and they are available in a 3000K option, which is a little bit warmer than what you may expect to see at with the LED lighting that you might be used to seeing on other sites. So there's only really six of those in this area here to cover the parking area, and then we have four traditional LED outdoor luminaires, and these are for the sidewalks located here and the pedestrian areas in the back. This is a photometrics plan. If you're used to looking at these, it's basically showing that zero at the property line here, or that we're where we've located these, we're not contributing to light trespass.
Just curious, while you're on it, the pedestrian is also Galleon?
No. Pedestrian is they're 10 feet tall. They sort of simulate a lantern, but the light's directed towards the ground. They're very similar to what's out there now. We'd submitted some catalog cuts. I might have some here if you're interested in seeing what they look like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't think they're in the...
I have no challenge with them. This is just out of my curiosity and education.
That's fine. Good question. They're basically chosen to look, sort of mimic what's out there, but here's the Galleon lighting. It's just LED, simple kind of light.
Mm-hmm.
And the pedestrian is obviously shorter. It looks a little bit more residential friendly.
Huh.
Looks like that. And these are to mimic the ones that were done in 2003.
Thank you.
This is the pedestrian sort of friendly lighting. Again, the light's up here and it focuses mm-hmm. down.
Oh, can I see one?
Yep.
That around after you look at it. Thanks.
That's really all I have prepared for the site. I was going to get into having Sid come up and talk a little bit about the elevations we provided and what the goal is to with the massing and to sort of connect these structures together and then architecture. And then.
You can't see the lamp.
Mm-hmm. I like it.
Good evening. My name is Sid Silvera. I'm with DMS Design, the architects for the project. And in terms of the exterior of the building and the massing, we tried to take a little bit from the original building, which is the building we're immediately bumping into, and also the previous addition. Massing, we're matching the height of the existing building, and material-wise, we are, design-wise, we're going with vertical elements such as they had in the existing building. We also have through-wall air conditioners, which is the cooling feature in both buildings, the original and the addition, and we have baseboard heat. So we're taking that same MEP approach as the existing building. They're very happy with it, and we kind of still took that idea from the existing building. It's tough to see here, but there's a low band, roof band on the existing building. We kind of mimicked that with a band of our own separating the second and third floor. There's a little bit of a transition band on the addition, but it's less prominent. Also material-wise, we have an asphalt shingle roof to match the 2003 addition. We have two types of vinyl siding. The lower course here is probably a 7-inch exposure, a larger exposure, matching the color of the 2003 addition. The upper two floors our 4-inch exposure, also matching, roughly matching the color of the existing 2003 edition. And as Jesse alluded to, we had very limited site in terms of coverage. So we try to keep the building as small as possible. And as a result, we have a mansard roof. So we have exterior gutters at the perimeter of the eave, but we also have internal roof drains, and the roof would hide the rooftop equipment cooling, so none of that is on the ground.
Is there a screening on the roof for the?
No, the roof eave, the roof ridge itself is actually higher than the equipment that we up there. So it's a little tough to see. We don't there's no image of the previous addition, but like I said, material-wise, most of that came from the original 2003 addition, and in terms of massing in vertical and horizontal elements, kind of matching the original building.
Are you doing the outside of the house that's already there?
The house will be resided to match the same color pattern as the addition there. Vinyl windows too, as well. Thank you.
Thanks.
Do have a pretty extensive landscape plan. The idea here, we do have some trees in the front of the building, and we've done our best to keep those. The idea of the landscape plan was to enhance that. We actually picked up with survey all the trees here, and we located this parking area in an area where it's mostly grass now. It does feature some infill growth of that to keep the buffer to the street. It also has some foundation plantings around the exterior, and then this is the courtyard area in the back here where there'd be some outdoor seating. That was the idea there, try to connect this community with the 2003 and original addition. Black and white rendering, but it's from the corner of the street of North King Street, and which is located here, and this is Coles Meadow. Just get an idea, and this sort of has some of the trees and shrubbery we're talking around the foundation there, and what that may look like. Along the street, it was important that we try to keep the trees, so this is sort of a rendering here, just giving you an idea that we are attempting to keep the buffer along the street there and keep some of those trees here, and then supplement them in the back with new plantings.
So that's Coles Meadow?
This is not Coles Meadow. This is North King Street here.
Yeah. So that previous one was from right on the corner?
Yes. So this is right on the corner.
So if you're driving north on...
Driving north and you were to look out your driver's side window, yeah, that's what you'd see. The other view that I show you is if you were by the state police barracks or down by, coming to the south, you'd be looking at it in that direction. And there is, you'll see those, there's a, some pine trees along that area and some other evergreen growth, and we're attempting to keep that there. Basically, there's a sidewalk there, and right behind the sidewalk, there's some of these trees, and tried to place the site. It is really tight, but tried to place it such that we could keep that buffer to the street here, and then with the planting plan, we enhanced the buffer along and around the building as well.
The fenced-in part is how large, and it's around on the other side. Is that right?
Yeah. You want to talk a little bit about that? Let's get a little better view of that. First floor, this is the gardens area that was talked about earlier. This is where the folks with dementia and memory support would be on this floor. So this is one of the benefits of this. And the area you're talking about in the back here is this gardens courtyard.
It's roughly 20 by 50, thereabouts. Probably a little bit larger than that. 25 by 60, I believe. And as Jesse mentioned, it's just strictly for the dementia wing. We call it a wandering garden. It gives them a place to go and be outside. And it's inaccessible from the exterior. The gates that you see there would be you know, on a fire alarm, if fire alarm were to go off, they'd have access out. It's a vinyl fence, 6 foot tall with lattice tops or privacy screening.
Do the top floors have access that's separate from the bottom floor?
Do the top floors have access to the garden?
No.
No.
Do you have access to the top
two floors that's separate from access to the bottom floor?
Correct.
So there's
yes.
not a commingling?
No. Okay. This is a entry lobby for the second and third floor. Mm-hmm. They come in, they can either use the stair or the elevator. They have their own separate entrance.
Okay.
And this is an egress stair from the top two floors, which goes straight outside, does not interact with the lower floor.
So the first floor is a secure unit?
Mm-hmm.
For how large?
15 units. Then these 10 units here in the original building are also converted to memory support. And then there's a separation there, physical separation with a door that would also be tied to the alarm or delayed opening as well.
A little more on here, the gardens in the rear, they're proposing a little seating area. And like a pergola, and there is access out through there, like we said. So.
And you had mentioned about the mix for a mass health population, and how are you projecting that as far as this particular building?
Sure. With the Gardens neighborhood, the original building is this is actually part of the original building, and of course we move in, so the from the entryway into the gardens down through into the new building, of course that's all of the suites for the assisted living memory support neighborhood. From this point over, that's where on the first, second, and third floor of the original building you would have all three of those floors for Mass Health, which would be the level 4 residential care rest home.
Yes.
Yep.
So we had that was a comment that was brought up. Well, it's hard to see here. It's in this area here, and we figured people would be coming in the main entrance and parking, and then there's access. Remember, this is the new addition. The main entrance of the facility is in here, so we wanted to be central to those locations.
So they have to provide parking for the entire community of the, I didn't want to say facility. So you're welcome.
Well,
not just the new.
Right. So the response was that they already have 14, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
Existing
so.
Spaces.
Right. Yeah.
So
okay.
Then we just look at, so we look at the gap, and there wasn't really much of a gap at all. So.
Okay. So. We could look at it and say, well, it's located conveniently for the existing building. And
oh, yeah, I see what you're saying. I think it would make sense that if there's already some existing mm-hmm. storage capacity or facilities mm-hmm. On site, that it makes more sense that the new ones be located as close as possible to the new building, mm-hmm. which is, I think, mm-hmm. what you're getting at, which...
Yeah.
Probably makes sense. So it's dispersed,
right?
You know,
yeah.
across the community.
Is that something that? Oh, go ahead. Tell me what your take on it.
No, that's fine. If you have a better location, I mean, we got to remember here. You know, we are a retirement facility. There's some bikers, but I think it's.
Well, I was going to ask you.
I think they have two.
Like staff.
Staff does bike, and this is there's actually a garage here and staff entrance right here. Beth actually works in this portion here. So there are entrances here,
mm-hmm.
The main entrance to the facility or the community is here. And of course we have entrance here. So we were thinking that was the best spot, away, secure, close to our the main entrance in the new pedestrian walk, but also able to be used for the service folks, which seem to be on this site, the ones that mostly have the bikes. I mean, mm-hmm. I think they said you have two existing residents, so we have 100 units now with two that would bike, and more staff that bike.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the impetus is why that went there.
You're proposing 5 new staff members, but did I take that to mean shift?
Yeah.
So you would have 15 new employees?
Yeah. The five new staff is what we came up with just to try to study the traffic. I'm probably overestimating a little bit the staff needs, and I'll let them discuss that.
Yeah, I think we all understand that that would be your biking community, but it segues into, I would like to talk about the traffic plan.
Sure. With the staffing on shift, there would be maybe three or so additional staff members during the busier time, the day and the evening shift. During the night shift, again, maybe an additional one or one and a half for that 8-hour span for actual staffing.
15 of the first floor units?
Right. Yeah, because we currently already have a Gardens neighborhood, you're only adding an additional staff person per shift because of the actual numbers of residents that it actually increases by. Okay. So, yeah, it's not an exponential number of additional employees.
So I don't know if you're wanting to speak to the traffic plan, but I do want to talk about it. Is it
sure.
Okay? So the second and third floor, the target audience is 62 and over. So I'm very close. And your traffic plan says that you project that half of those people will have cars. So I want to talk about how reasonable that is from what you know about your services so far.
Yeah, we can talk about that now. You know, the existing unit breakdown of the 100 that are there now, you might know it off the top of your head. So they have 39, right now of the 100 units, they have 39 level 4, 18 memory support. And so most of those, no driving.
Right. It's only the second, third floor I'm interested in.
The cottages here, which are 12, which some have cars.
Uh-huh.
They have parking and carports for those. The remaining 40, or excuse me, 40, it'd be less than that, it'd be 30 or so. Remaining in here, a very small percentage of those have cars.
About 5 or so.
Yeah, and I think we used even 10 to 15 as a high amount. So if we project those to this facility, this new area here. Now, granted, there's 39 new units, but remember, 15 of those are of the type of memory support.
Right.
So the balance of the 25, we're only about half. Would be drivers.
Yeah, I was convinced that you had every incentive to calculate enough parking for your campus. So, I mean, I think you're handling the parking part of this fine, but I just, as I look at a level D of service along King Street, which is a very poor traffic grade for that street, and I look at your traffic mitigation plan and how you've sort of looked at what your additional traffic will be, I'm not convinced that we've got them all counted is really where I'm going with it.
Yeah, well, we did count them. We counted in and out. It's a 24-hour facility, so there are three shifts. You know, we did, 6 hours of counts on two different days. Really when we're talking about impacts on the street here, we're talking about peak hour, so either in the AM or the PM. And remember, this community, they have folks that come around lunchtime, and that's where a lot of the transients come in and out, nurse staff. So it really doesn't correspond with generally with what the street out here is doing.
Uh-huh.
It is a level service D. That's what we started at, no build, and when we're done, we're still a level service D. And if you're adding 20 or even 30 trips there, it's not enough of a percentage to go up, and we're talking a few percent.
Right.
Granted, D isn't the greatest. You designed for level C or better, but I don't think we're making this adverse. This type of use is not a big traffic generator, and I think if you compare that in your bylaw with other types of residential uses or commercial uses, and that's kind of what's vetting out here.
Well, yeah, the traffic plan approaches it from the 39 additional units, but then I'm sort of trying to get my head around how many people that is. Now, I admit that I put your five staff per each shift, so you've straightened me out there. But That'll bring the total property to 139. Now, that's the total property. That's your existing and these new units.
Correct.
So it's one resident in the unit? Could you?
The majority of time.
Okay.
There may be some couples. And a couple of the other good points in terms of the traffic, with the population that lives there, the majority of the trips and travel that they usually take are, you know, between the 10 o'clock to 2:30 or 3, not, you know, not before it's light, not after it's dark. So that does also help with some of the different time parameters.
Well, can I hear what you expect in the way of increase of
administrative, kitchen, dietary, nursing, maintenance, physical therapy? I mean, your increase in residents will generate something you'll notice there?
For other staff members? You know, again, really looking at the operations and the services that we're going to be offering, it really only brings in an additional, again, like three and a half-ish day, evening, again, one additional person during the night. So, again, not really, not intensive because of what we already have in place and the economies of scale.
Okay.
I got you. Two questions. One is why the 62 distinction as opposed to 60, or is it?
That's a good question.
Convention.
It's something that we have. It's the age that we have always had.
Social Security.
But one of the things too, we do present this option to people 62 and above, but generally speaking, our average age is 83, 84.
Okay. Yeah.
So, and we're attempting to try to find a younger grouping of people to move into Violet's Crossing, the second and third floor, but most likely we'll probably see 75 and above. I'm hopeful maybe we'll look for some youngers, but we have two sisters that want to live together in their 80s.
And if someone moves into the second or third floor of this new building,
sure.
Barring that they somehow become financially unable to pay their rent, mm-hmm. You said they're going to be rental.
Yes.
Would they always be able to receive supportive services in their unit and remain there through the end of life?
That is a beautiful question. What we're able to offer, because we have the residential care neighborhood, one of the hopes is that if people start progressing and need additional services, the medication management, little personal care, three meals a day, full housekeeping, all of those types of services, they can move to our residential care neighborhood. But there are other things, I'm sure maybe some of you have heard of PACE programs. There are a lot of incentives out there with the state with Medicare, Medicaid programs that will also hopefully start to help. Home health agencies that, again, people can bring in to the apartments, and we're going to help.
So people would be able to bring services in as well from a.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Okay. Yep. So a lot of different avenues that we're going to work with these ladies and gentlemen to keep them in those apartments as long as possible.
And I'm sorry, just one more.
Sure.
So if they were eligible income-wise for community-based services, mm-hmm. they could be brought into their home just as if they lived, you know.
Right.
Okay.
John's going to sign up.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Question, if the anticipated traffic impact is minimal, why the need for a 24-foot wide service entrance? It seems like a lot of bituminous for...
It's actually the service entrance is at the curb cut here is already that wide. We're not really widening it. Where we are widening it is in this area here, and that's so we can, you know, we have this 90-degree parking here, so we need to be able to get in and out there. The other reason is, you know, this is a state highway, so they have rules on the curb cuts and the width here. We're not doing a lot of work here because this was already previously done in 2003. Originally, there was more work that was proposed under that, but they just ended up not doing it. So really, it's just for circulation here.
That's, I don't know if you saw the staff comments, that's wider than 22 feet is a road width. So. Do you need two more feet for an entrance that, by your own account, isn't going to be that much utilized? It just seems like a lot of pavement for...
I mean, it's consistent with everything that's here. This entrance is the same, 24. I think it's important to have that width where you have head-in parking. That's like a standard parking stall through the city.
Parking lot's one thing, a road, the entrance, it seems like a lot.
Well, you want two-way, and you want, you know, people are making turning movements here and in here. This isn't very long here.
Do you have a sidewalk there?
There is no sidewalk here. Yeah, I mean, what this is for is just, again, is for staff and limited residents. You know, staff would be in this area here. The residents of this unit, the top two floors that might have parking are set up here very close to their separate entrance, so.
You'll have faster traffic coming and going in and out of that the wider you make it. Now, that's just a fact.
Yeah, and again, we're not making this wider here. It is already that wide.
But you could narrow, once you get in around the radius, it could be narrowed. I think that's probably one of the one of the other main issues, too. Even if your curb cut is 24 feet, which is the standard for commercial driveways.
I mean, we could narrow it, but you got to remember, if there are drivers, these are, you know, older drivers. And I think the extra maneuverability is warranted. I mean, I really do. But, and I think the amount, I mean, this isn't very big here. The amount that you're going to reduce it. I mean, we can look at it if that's a condition or if that's something you want us to look at. You know, in this area of the parking, it's 24, you know, to here. This is a throat of the entrance where you might have cars stacking waiting to turn. This area here, you need this width to be able to have someone to back out and go. So there would only be a really narrow area where you could narrow that up. And I'm not seeing a big reduction in impervious there.
We do only have a requirement for 18 feet of backup space behind. I know the standard for commercial retail parking lots certainly is wider than 18 feet.
I mean, if you want us to narrow it up to 22, we could. I would not want to go any less than that. I mean, you know.
We do have the delivery trucks, the big delivery trucks coming in for the food and paper supply,
linens.
Yeah, so
in the back here, there's a loading dock, you know, so that's sort of why that's.
Yeah, that's, I mean, to me, that's not an issue getting through the parking lot and needing the space in the parking lot. It's just the road itself. I don't see the justification for 2 foot wider than a road. I mean, that's what you'd have in an industrial park, a 24 foot wide road, and that's not what your community purports to be, so it's not a lot of bituminous, but it's too much bituminous. So.
Well, but I will give them credit for putting in the pavers. I
mean,
I agree. On the right-hand side where you've got the pavers and there's the dotted line, is that the wetlands boundary?
Yeah, this is wetlands in here. This is the 100-foot buffer, so we're just kind of just on the periphery of that.
Okay.
We have filed.
So you're showing a generator?
Yes, yeah, so there's an existing generator there now.
Or do you have two generators?
No, we have to add one. And the way it was explained to me is that the generator here is for this facility. There isn't any more capacity in that. Mm-hmm. And if you wanted to go to a larger one, it would be much, much bigger, and it's it would be louder. So if we can keep to the same size, they have better sound enclosures and residential silencer systems. So it'd be very similar to the one that's there now, mm-hmm. Maybe even a little bit smaller. In my experience, they do have timers, so that can be set. I'm not sure when they exercise now.
I'm pretty certain we exercise them Monday early mornings, so we can set it on whatever schedule.
Are you wanting them to go at the same time or to be staggered?
I actually don't know. I just noticed that now you're adding, you know, there'll be another generator with exercise time.
Yeah.
So it's just a thought.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It'd probably be better to stagger the times, I'd say. You know, the sound isn't additive, but, and it's, you know, usually what is it, 15 or 20 minutes? It's not a significant amount of time, but. That's something.
I think we've just mentioned it to you. It's yours to solve.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
That.
I would ask you to be aware of it, that
sure
you are introducing
sure
a second generator on that site.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Jesse, you'd mentioned you saw the staff comments on the temperature, the color of the light fixtures, the exterior light fixtures. Did you see on the intensity of the lights? There are some staff comments in some areas that were we're brighter than we need to be?
I don't know if I saw those comments.
Yes. Well, the zoning allows, because it's the zoning district is a low-density residential district.
Yeah.
We have lower light level allowances.
Yeah. I mean, we did our best to keep it low. It's almost impossible to reach that level. I mean, you can see here, we don't have very many lights. And
My recommendation to the board was maybe to allow it above the standard level for a residential use, because it's not a single family or, you know, mm-hmm. subdivision. I think your maximum light level was 2.9 or something.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have 2.5, that's it. We have 2.8, 2.6, and it's 1.4.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really not. That 2.5, I mean, I'm not sure where you guys got. That's pretty difficult to meet. I mean, you know, you, especially in a parking area close to a building where, you know, the handicapped spaces, I mean, we're right at the minimum here.
I think the comments were on the fixture 7, 8, 9, because they're on the residential side, to if we can reduce the...
Yeah, 7, 8, 9, those are walkway paths, and those are not 2.5. So if I'm looking here, I got 2.1. If you look right, you can look right on the plan there.
Yep.
Those are not the entire pieces.
Yeah, the maximum levels actually in the district are less than one. So I don't know if there's a way to reduce them. My recommendation to the board was maybe 1.5 or something, so that's a little bit lower on the residential neighborhood side of the building, if that's possible.
I mean, that's very similar to what they have there now. The only thing I think you could do is you could have the little bollard lighting. I mean, this is a pretty low watt, smallest LED light, you know, 12 foot tall. It's not. I mean, we could look to remove one or something if there's a concern, but I mean, you still have no light trespass.
You
so.
Do have to think about the population you're dealing with here, though, in terms of... Mm-hmm.
It is a lower light level. I just read, because there's, I mean, you would be granting a waiver, so that was just mm-hmm. a recommendation from staff, but you all can obviously mm-hmm. approve what's submitted, but include that in your decision as a waiver.
I mean, yep. if it's a problem, I mean, we certainly can come back with something else. I just think we try to. I understand the regulations and the limits were, but I'm trying to walk the fine line here, I guess. But I certainly don't think it's bright or overdone by any stretch of the means here. But instead of those type lights we talked about, I mean, we could do something a little bit lower to the ground, but again, I mean, these are the types of folks that would be using these. I think it's important to have at least some minimum lighting here. And, you know, there are parts here, you know, we're under one and they cross. I mean, it's just really, you get that where you're right under the light where it's most intense. But
Yeah, I'm a little worried about that, where it drops down so much, because from what I understand on the lighting is, especially with people that you know, maybe are at a disadvantage with their eyesight anyway, is you want to avoid the bright and the shadow and the bright, you know, so traveling from being underneath a lamp and then kind of going into shadow, and then you're back under a lamp and the light is brighter. So I think the lighting plan could be improved, both for your residents and
you need to make it more consistent on the
make
resident
it more
side?
Consistent, yeah, because I think you're going to have pools of light and then sort of
have,
shadows
have,
pools of light
you're
shadows
have, you're gonna have 20 little bollard lights to get what you guys want. I mean,
I don't agree
sure
with
it.
That I don't think it's to try to avoid the pools of light and the shadows. I don't think that means you have to go to 20 bollard lights.
What's the height of this fixture? 12 feet, you said?
Yeah,
8?
I think yeah.
Do you have that cut sheet? Can I see that again?
Well, I do want to confirm that I like that they're LED. I like that they're down lighting.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we certainly look at it. I mean, we have a lighting consultant, so we can certainly look at that. But
I don't want it to get
dark.
Because
I don't know where those numbers came from, but they're... If you look at what this light IECC lighting standards are, they're way above that for a type of facility like this. So I think part of it is because this is in a residential district, and it is residence, but if you looked at what elderly care lighting is, it's 10 times what that is, you know, for something like that. So it's, we're trying to balance a fine line here. And I understand the bylaw is set up for the entire district, but if you were to look at elderly care or that type of use, it would be much, much higher than the zoning.
Well, I think we're just, I mean, you're a community within the neighborhood, and we're trying to
be aware of that. The street lights that are out here would be way above this, you know, so.
There's no question.
Yeah.
So this is a.
I'm sure you would, it would be, you know, you'd be making the area much worse. But it sounds like you guys have strong feelings about it, so we can certainly give it a shot.
This is a 10-foot pole, by the way, so.
It's not a.
Could you flip back to one of the, that shows the larger site kind of in the context of the neighborhood?
Sure.
Or the community? Yeah.
I mean, you do have some residents across the street here, but we do have a bunch of trees here. And one thing that the lighting plan doesn't look at is, you know, any shadow you'd have from that. So it doesn't take into account those trees that are there, so. And the landscaping we're going to be adding. In particular, this area here, where that house would be. So there's, it's hard to see here, but here's the existing condition plan. You can see there's, we're coming out, proposing to come out with this garage right now. But there's all these trees along here, you know, 15, 10, triple oak, 14 pine. There's a lot of trees in here, a lot of trees in here.
It's something we can look at if you want us to stick to the 2.5 max and certainly.
Well, it's a fine line if we want to be under the 2.5 and we don't want any.
You can see there it's
below,
not.
You're either going to have to increase the amount of.
You got to increase the amount of lights, and you're going to have to use it. Yeah, I mean,
that's what I meant by it. Just you're going to have a lot more. So
if you add another 10-foot pole, you'll have another hot spot, and that will.
All those values will go up, and maybe you won't have as much, but it's kind of an iterative thing.
Well, we're sort of communicating two different messages to them, and
I think
being a little mixed. I think it is a special community, and I think it's a fine line to walk. I don't want to add extra lights that we don't need, but I think I want enough lights so that it functions well for the same reason you do.
I guess if the applicant thinks that the as designed, it has enough, the lighting is adequate. Then it's on us to. And but right now it doesn't. It's more than zoning requires.
We would have to grant it with a waiver.
I mean, if I was, I would have a lot more, you know, more light if I could. And we're trying to balance that. We understand, but trying to balance it.
I don't want to design it for them, but I just feel like the lighting design could be better. Both in terms of hotspots and really to serve your residents. And I'm concerned about the fixture you showed, even though the LEDs are on the same plane as the full cutoff, that lantern shape, I think you're gonna have glare. So even though it's considered a full cutoff, it's going to go out the sides. And again, you know, I don't know that this is an issue for the zoning. I'm just, it's more a concern that you have a really good, efficient lighting plan that benefits
They have these now.
I was going to say, we were just kind of collaborating on what we have in other communities now, and this is consistent with what we have in other places. Haven't really experienced any problems, and I think most likely attributed to there's not a lot of walking traffic out at night.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is similar to what we've used. Mm-hmm.
So I will offer just a little bit different perspective. I think that goes along with Carla's point. As the neighbor of one of your, I don't know if you call them competitors, that recently expanded, the lighting for the neighbors is one of the most important things because it's there when it wasn't there before. So I think there needs to be some sensitivity to that, to, you know, your community, but also the community across the street, you know, because it will change their view. And, you know, certainly we live just as close as people are going to live here. Bright spots, things like that, you know, if it was, you know, I guess more, but less intense, you know, I think from the external view, that's going to be an improvement as well. I mean, so just remember that perspective, that, you know, the light is going to be something that was not there before that is there now. So anything you can do, you know, to mitigate that is helpful, I think, to the neighbors.
We're nice and confident with the plan that they've put together lighting-wise. And the good thing with this parking area, of course, is that we're going to be helping just give more light, if anything, to the state police barracks or the car shop, whichever the name of it is here. And there's that great buffer of wetlands and trees here for Laurel Park, so that really wouldn't be a concern. And here, with a few more lights, we do have all of the lighting here in the parking lot already for our neighbors on Coles Meadow Road. So that shouldn't have too much really of an impact with additional lighting on this side. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, again, we want to keep that down to a minimum, but this hopefully would not impact, because I do understand what you're saying, yeah.
Any other comments by the board? Is there anyone here from the public who would like to comment on this? Okay, if you could, I'll raise your hand. I'll call on you. If you could come up to the podium and just give us your name and where you live, and we'll hear what you have to say.
My name's Norma Roach from 42 Laurel Park, and my neighbor and I just wanted to see the map.
If we could do that.
See the map?
Yeah.
Yep.
Can she come up too?
Absolutely. Do you have any particular questions, or you just?
So here are the cottages here.
Okay.
The brick buildings in the front. Mm-hmm. The addition from 2003 is in here. Okay. They're at this lower corner. This is where the existing one-story house is.
Okay.
Okay, so it's not a great impact on the wetlands.
No, it's not at all.
That was a concern of ours.
Okay.
I heard there was some concern there. We're as far away from that as kind of property as we can here. So where you guys garden there, that's preserved. We're not filling in here.
So the gardens are good, okay.
Yeah, they're not proposing to build in here at all. So.
And with the lighting you increase, where
it's down here.
It's down here, which is...
Yeah, there's buildings in between, I would say. It wouldn't be hitting you guys.
So that doesn't impact... Well, there is a back entrance.
Yeah, that's back here.
Yeah, okay.
And, you know, the lights that they're talking about are here and in the front here, so...
Yeah, I mean, just...
I think as far as Laurel Park is concerned, I think, again, you'll probably see it here. This kind of shows a little bit. You guys are up in here. Here was the previous 2003.
Mm-hmm.
They're down here.
Yep.
Can't really get too much farther away from here.
Okay. Yeah, you know, I was going to say anything would just be, we'd be not wanting more noise or more light, but we've discussed all of that, so.
Thanks.
Thank you.
We will be recycling all of these at the end of the evening.
You want to take one home? You want a souvenir?
You want to share one with people.
Do you have any objection to that?
Any other questions from the public? Any other comments from the board?
So DPW sent their comments. I forwarded them on this afternoon.
I also spoke with David Valletta yesterday. I don't think he had any real concerns. We had a couple of invert errors, and we submitted a plan to correct them. He was happy with that.
Yeah.
And he just wants to see some final construction details on the pump station and things like that. So.
There were minor details except for one. The DPW asked for specs on the sidewalks that I think I didn't realize before, but as he raised it, I realized, you know, we do have the requirement in the site plan that sidewalk construction be consistent with what we require in subdivision regs. So DPW's comments weren't exactly consistent with that requirement in zoning. So I just want to clarify, maybe as a permit condition, they will have to resubmit final construction plans anyway prior to construction. So just put a note on there that, in particular, sidewalk construction has to be what we require in zoning, and then obviously subdivision.
You had a little cookbook, and you said that's not what you want. You want
to No. The cookbook is fine, except for your reference was 4 feet. We don't allow 4 foot wide sidewalks anymore. They have to be 5 feet. Okay. So.
Well, and that's why I asked about the sidewalk along King Street. Uh-huh. We have, you know, we've put sidewalks along Route 9 mm-hmm. in the hope that they would eventually be
right.
contiguous with the other properties. And you've got Laurel Park, a dense area there that would, you know, it wouldn't solve the whole problem immediately, but I would love to see a sidewalk along King Street there.
Well, one of the
it's already there. That was done in the 2003.
Yeah, the previous project.
So this we actually they did a couple thousand feet actually. Yep. So
we thank you.
Yeah. So we're kind of closing the loop here. So.
Okay, I was reacting to you saying no, there wasn't a minute ago.
Well, and then the other piece of it is relative to traffic mitigation.
Right.
The applicant has. Agreed, you know, based on the traffic study that they submitted, they're showing much lower levels than the zoning presumes, and so they're offered to meet that with a reduced mitigation amount of 26,000 and change, I think, and I put that as a proposed condition.
Right.
But they've submitted a memo stating that they would meet that obligation. That could be put towards construction, continuing that sidewalk towards,
on the
you
south
know,
side.
Yeah.
I mean, you get a lot of sidewalk for that. I mean.
Mm-hmm. Okay, public comment section still open? Do we have
I move we close public comment?
Second, yeah. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay, public comment is closed. Any discussion, more discussion by the board? So we've had a few issues. One was the width of the driveway, which I had issues with. Carla, you're talking about bike storage and lighting.
Yeah, well, if the owners are comfortable with the lighting and it works on your other properties, then I'll leave it at that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we'd have to ask for a grant a waiver with mm-hmm. respect to that. Mm-hmm. And the bike storage, it seems.
So if it's near the other entrance, and I guess in this case really service entrance or staff entrance,
right.
it's in a good location
right.
because there is, they've met the storage.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. covered storage for the residents,
mm-hmm.
so I'm fine with that.
Anybody else? How does everybody feel about the width of the driveway issue? I get the comments, but 24 feet, that's a road.
Yeah.
And I don't know that we need.
Yeah.
And for the sake of 2 feet, 22 feet is ample size to back up and turn around.
It's not already down.
What's that?
It's 22 feet already, but as it goes back,
the curb
not
cut.
Already. But as
right.
but what's back there is not already
Correct.
That wide.
Correct.
Well, and I'm going to go back to the sidewalk. When I asked you about the, you know, what was there, that what I was thinking was about the speed of the turning traffic. And so, since you do have a sidewalk there, I just say again, traffic goes slower when they have to make a tighter turn. So, honestly, it's. I don't think it's an imposition. We're actually guiding you through what we've learned, I hope.
We're closed, by the way, also, so.
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to entice you.
any other comments? So we had the lighting levels, they met the 3000K, the color, so that was okay. We need to grant a waiver. The driveway width, we're comfortable with that. We need to resubmit plans per the DPW on the sidewalk construction.
Well, and other details too. So we just
other
I think
so DPW comments in general.
Yeah, I think just revised final plan before building permit.
So Mark, you stated that as we're comfortable with the width of the driveway. Are you comfortable with 22?
Correct. Correct.
And I actually just would go on record as saying, once they're into their parking area, I'm fine with that end of it.
I agree.
We're not raising the island.
Yeah.
It's fine. So wait, so you're saying you'd rather have the curb cut narrow, but they could be 24 feet after that?
Once you get to the parking.
Once you get to the parking.
So 22 feet.
After the Y.
To the Y.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm sympathetic to the older driver getting in and out of parking places.
I know it's closed. I can't change it at the street because that's Mass Highway. After that.
Correct. Right, after the throat. Yeah. And traffic mitigation, we talked about that. They're receptive to that, but we still need to make that a condition.
Yeah, it can't hurt just to say that we would need that prior to certificate of occupancy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think that's it.
I'd like to say I like you keeping the lower level house on the streetscape. That's a nice way to scale into the building. So you could have taken that down, but I liked it.
Right, I agree.
I like that they're using already disturbed area to put this new addition, and the elevations look very nice.
Right.
Really fit in.
I think it's in keeping with what they've already done.
Mm-hmm.
It follows that design, and I like the design.
Yeah,
I like where it is, the scale of it, everything about it. Can I hear a motion?
Before, just in the abundance of caution, I do work in the elder services world. I used to work in Hampshire County. I have not worked in Hampshire County, which would occasionally bring me in contact with this facility, but in no way do I have any kind of ownership or anything. I now work in Berkshire County, so I just wanted to put that out there.
Sounds good and clean.
Okay.
I move we approve special permit and site plan to amend original permit by adding three-story 31,479 square foot addition to Rockridge by Deaconess Abundant Life Communities at 25 and 37 Coles Meadow Road, Northampton, map ID 1373, with the conditions that there is a waiver on the light intensity, and we would like those to be at 3,000 Kelvin, that there's traffic mitigation funds to be set aside in accordance with the letter, and that will be done prior to the certificate of occupancy, that the width of the driveway past the curb cut be reduced to 22 feet, except in an adjacent area to the parking, and that the DPW comments be revised in the final plan.
Before building permits issued, they'll resubmit final plans.
Before permit is issued, you will resubmit final plans.
Second.
Secondhand. Any discussion?
I'm sorry. Are we saying that the driveway is 22 feet at the curb cut?
It's 24 now.
Right.
So right after you come in, it'll be reduced to 22.
Right after you
until you get to the parking, and then.
Very good. Thank you.
We have a motion, a second. Any more discussion? No? All in favor? There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice facility.
Thank you.
I had to do it.
Yes, what?
Right.
What? I could do planning tonight.
What? It said, it was very specific. We're going to do planning tonight. That's because you don't feel well.
We won't take
it. No. Well, it was strategic in that. I hope it's working out right. We're missing two members.
Mm-hmm.
And in 2 weeks, we actually don't have any permit hearings, so we thought we'd address Star Communities, long-range planning. What was the other thing?
LED lighting?
Well, no, it was part of planning.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the sustainable plan, Star Communities, and there was one other piece to that. And we could do the LED lighting, too, because obviously there are two members that really wanted to participate in that conversation.
Right.
So we thought we would just, you know, go in, roll up our sleeves, and spend a good, solid, you know,
30 minutes.
15, 20 minutes.
To do that on the 26th, so.
So now, like, if we're not here, it's going to really look bad, because you've said this is what we're going to do.
It always looks bad if you're not here.
So, sir, anything to call, like, to review or to prepare for this discussion?
Well, it's interesting, is one of the things that Wayne and I were talking about is, well, maybe we should do a quick description here, let you guys mull things over, and then come back. And but then, sort of thinking about that, we thought, well, maybe what we should do, because we are missing two members, maybe we should just go in, make a long session of it, and then do smaller bits in other meetings. So give you guys time to think about it, and then maybe spend half hour at subsequent meetings mm-hmm. to sort of do follow-up. Mm-hmm. That's the
When you mention the sustainability plan, I think about the very generalized goals that are in there,
right.
And I wonder how you see us translating those into nuts and bolts decisions about right. properties.
That's what we need
That's
to talk
what
about.
We need to talk about. Okay.
Because as we do the amendments, the idea, what we'll go over is that because it's so general, we really need to narrow it down, focus it, and figure and make it more strategic, and look at more, get into those nuts and bolts, you know, and also change some of the codify some of the policies, sort of the broad policies, and make it more useful and applicable. It also, based on our STAR communities rating, there were some comments, reasons we didn't get points is because we have a lot of fluffy aspirational language in there.
But I resisted motherhood
and apple pie. Okay, which way are we going? What's that?
Did they not know who they were talking to? They were surprised by this.
Too fluffy.
So that's where the work comes.
Does everybody have a copy of that?
Probably not, but we can send stuff ahead of that. We're going to do PowerPoint. We're going to sort of bring it. And the other piece of it is we've winnowed away a lot of the recommendations, you know, over the last 5 years. We've implemented zoning. So mm-hmm. part of it is to identify all the things we've, you know, done and where we are and what steps are next. And so there'll be big chunks of it that we still need to focus on. I mean, one of the things that we really didn't do so well was climate adaptation, and that's another big piece that we want.
Yeah,
and that's another big piece that we're going to.
And we've still got the appeal on the 9th.
Yes. So I didn't want to push it to the 9th because
right.
we have other things going on there too.
Okay. So if we have no planning tonight, and we've already had two hearings and have approved the minutes.
Motion to adjourn.
I need a motion.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So.